There's always either a lack of clarity or not a full understanding of what the tourism board does. The tourism board is a state corporation that was established 20 years ago that sits under the Ministry of Tourism with the sole mandate of marketing the destination. Now let me differentiate between what the tourism ministry does, what Grand Kenya does, and what we do, which is probably the question that you wanted to find out, okay? So the tourism industry is specifically focused on aspects that deliver on tourists, either local, regional, or internationally, for the destination. The destination is Kenya. Kenya Tourism Board is like the marketing division of that company called Ministry of Tourism. We have regulators, we have the Kenyatta International Convention Center, we have Tourism Fund that looks after the levies, we have Habutali that builds capacity, we have Tourism Finance Corporation that finances and looks for investors within the tourism industry. We have the Tourism Regulatory Authority that regulates the industry both from a perspective of providing permits as well as setting or classifying tourism locations. Oh, and then BOMAs of Kenya. BOMA is now a cultural wing or a cultural arm of tourism that is supposed to showcase the various cultures within our 47 counties. So the role of the Kenya Tourism Board is a marketing role. And it markets the destination across a number of different facets. So it markets the destination from the perspective of the main tourism product, but we also market the destination with other things that we have within the destination that can help to either be influencers, ambassadors, support the profile of the destination, and make sure that people are looking at Kenya as a preferential area or a preferential location to visit, but more importantly, as a viable destination to holiday. We then have Brand Kenya that's supposed to be looking at the country brand and is a lot more diversified in terms of positioning the country brand. Now they would be positioning for trade, investment, they would be positioning for new entrants in terms of companies setting up headquarters here. They would be positioning for infrastructure projects that would be then considered or investments that would be made into the country. So it has a much broader role than we do. So does that help you understand as an opening, do we now understand where we are in terms of what the role that we play as a as the tourism board and the role that Grand Kenya or other tourism bodies play? I think it's important to understand that in order to market a destination, it's the same way as marketing a brand. So anything that is likely to change the perception of this brand, don't think about this as Kenya Tourism Board doing a marketing job. Think about Kenya being a brand such as KCB, such as Omo, such as Coca-Cola, such as Safaricom. So the role of KTB is to ensure that we build a brand for the country that is as strong as those brands, as strong and as resilient as those brands. So you will find as I go through the presentation, there are destinations that now are experiencing double-digit growth from having taken something as simple as, say, a Kakamega Forest and developed it into an export-ready tourism product. And I'll talk about how that happens. So what we've done, you're quite right, when you say the two products that we have concentrated on for all our lives, and they served us well since the days of Out of Africa, we've done a really good job with Safari Language. Our Safari product, as I'm sure you're well aware, the Mara is still the number one game app in the world. The Coast, however, has its challenges, and I'll talk about it. So from a Safari perspective, we are still able to offer an authentic Safari, which is what Dorothy is saying when she talks about Kakamega Forest. The traveler today is looking for an experience that is not is not, I don't want to use the word man-made, but is not stage managed. The same way you as journalists always want to know the real story, don't want to know the window dress story, you know, the one that I practiced last night, then I'm coming to tell you today. Then you ask me a question, I answer the one that I have in my head, not the real story. Even as journalists, you're able to tell that's not really the real story. So you probably go and find somebody else to find the real story. That's exactly the same way that tourists, all visitors operate. When people spend money to go to a destination, and with the opening up of destinations, that thing about chaperoning your guests from the day they arrive at the airport until the day they leave finished. People go to destinations to live in the destination. So they don't want you to set them up like they would be at home. They want to go to that destination and be able to leave that destination really understanding who are those people, what is their culture like, how do they enjoy life, what is their day-to-day habit, when they have time for relaxation, what do they normally do, not what they staged for me to do. So this business of having dancers meeting people at the airport with banana leaves, then they meet them at the hotel, then they dance around at lunch. At lunchtime, you have Maasai's jumping up and down, and they're not even Maasai's. That thing finished. Visitors can see through that. And that is what damages the preference for a destination. So, in the transformation of the industry, let's just talk about some money. Tourism ought to be amongst the big four. Because you will see the things that trigger a country to select their areas of focus are usually around the economic value, the impact of that industry on the populace as a whole, and the potential that industry has for growth in that economy over a long period of time. So the sustainability around that potential. So if you see these figures here, this is a market that contributes to countries trillions of dollars. And as you can see, it's growing. Usually for a thing like this, what you want to see is you want to see the trajectory, yeah? You want to see from a year-on-year basis, is it growing or not? So there's the direct contribution, and then there's the total contribution. And I'll talk about the direct contribution in a moment. But you can see that the total contribution surpasses the direct contribution. That tells you something. It tells you that apart from people coming and sleeping in a hotel or going on a safari or eating in a nice restaurant, there's a lot of other people that benefit from a tourist coming into the country. And this we can see here. Travel and tourism has significant indirect and induced impacts on other economic sectors. So if you look over here, this section here is about commodity. So these are the usual normal things. It's about accommodation, transportation, entertainment, and attractions. This section here is about industry. So think about this moment. Imagine we're all tourists. Look around and tell me what are some of the things that we have just heard in this country. Just here at the table. Just look around. Tell me what are some of the areas that we have directly impacted this moment. Agriculture. How? You're eating their food. Exactly. So those are now the things that help the experience but create and contribute employment to someone. So the fact that you have a tablecloth, like you couldn't have come here and found an empty table, means somebody got a job. Right? So things around retail, things around transportation. So remember, for every 10 tourists that come into the country, one job is created. And this is one physical job. I'm not talking about the backward integration of the taxi driver, the farmer, the person that provides craft. I'm not talking about all those things. I'm just talking about within the industry. So if you consider that, it means that the significance, especially tourism in Kenya, becomes one of the most important sectors. It also is the third highest foreign currency earner, and contributes to nearly a 10. Last year, we were up to 2016, it was 12%. Last year was about 10.2%. So if you consider that, just think about the total GDP, and you have one sector contributing that amount of money. Then you understand. Somebody said, why are we not part of the big four? We fall short on the aspect of sustainability. Why is that? Why do you think that when you talk about sustainability, tourism comes within that sector? When I'm considering, because think about it, I am a chief executive officer of a country and I'm stacking up the things that I must focus on. Longevity and ability to create wealth over a long period of time is important. Why will tourism not fall in that area? This is now obvious. What is the thing that affects tourism the most? Why? So what is that? Yeah, that's it. Exactly. It's security. Security is the number one killer of tourism in any market. So as journalists, every time I talk to journalists, I explain how powerful the whole thing is. Because when somebody reads something in a newspaper, or they see something on TV, or they hear something on radio, it doesn't matter if it is true or not, they believe it completely. So if you sort of casually just write how we were sort of having some skirmishes in the central business district, do you know how somebody sitting in, say, China, they take their central business district that has maybe 10 million people at any given go, and then they visualize having skirmishes around that area. And that is how they think the destination is. So every time we talk to Jack, we make sure that people understand that when you say that we had a rally where we had a stampede and a number of people were shot and died, somebody sitting in Poland thinks in their minds about their own rally, how it can be. And you know our rally, might have, no, I'm serious. It's really, really important to understand this. Our rallies might have maybe 5,000, no, our rallies might have maybe 40,000 people. Their rallies might have 2 million people. So the person is thinking, these guys, they had a thing where people were shooting, they were shooting into a car that has 2 million people, and then within there was a stampede. So they formed their own picture. And that really is what has been happening to the destination. So they think they're going to meet that thing at the airport. Like they seriously think they're going to meet it at the airport. You have conversations with private sector where they're asking, somebody has made a booking for a 10-day trip with a group of 15 or 20. They call their operator and ask, is it still safe for me to come? Can I land at the airport? Just think about it. He's actually talking to somebody on the other side. So unless the person is talking from his bed, under the carpet or somewhere, he hasn't processed in his mind that if I'm able to reach this person on an official line, he must be in the office. Which means that situation might not be as bad. But we constantly have to keep sending reassuring messages that says, yes, it is safe for you to come. Yes, you will not be stoned and shot at the airport. And no, we will not be waiting for you with stones on the passport. Okay? Now, it might sound sort of far-fetched, but that's exactly how the visitor feels. So it's really important that if we want to grow this sector, we understand the primary thing that affects tourism. So in terms of significance, I think we now get a really good idea of how significant the sector is. So when you look at a breakdown of travel and tourism, you will see that the total contribution in GDP is nearly 3 times the direct contribution. So as a sector, it's a very vibrant sector. But I don't think that's what you had a doubt about. You're probably wondering, why doesn't it grow as fast as we would imagine or expect? And we'll come to that in a bit. When you come, and I mentioned this, 11 tourists creating one job. The thing around this aspect is, you can see it's been sort of constant. But the thing to note is, look at this dip here. What was happening in 2008? Your journalist. What was happening in 2008? Okay. What was happening in 2020? 2012. What was happening in 2017, early 2016, 2017? So we now know the narrative. So we now know what the story is. So you can see, because we have over the years built the sector in such a way that it is affected by other economic, political, and social things that happen in the market. You now have an industry that is, you have very little control over, or you're not taking control of. So in the transformation agenda, that is one of the aspects that we're going to be focusing on. And there's a way to do it. Because you have countries like Jordan that border Syria, and they do not have a, they have twice the number of tourists that we have Jordan. You know when somebody tells you, oh, this country borders Syria, what do you think? Like, exactly where is that place? It borders Syria. What do you think? They don't have a problem with tourists. That's not the problem they have. Because they've completely changed the narrative. They saw this, just like we're seeing it now, they saw it about five or ten years ago, and started to make a deliberate effort to transform their industry into something that had nothing to do with whatever else was going on, which is what, in essence, we're trying to do. So, let me take you through some figures. This is how we, and you all have this information, isn't it? This information you have. We experienced a 9.8% growth last year. Tourism receipts are just over 100 billion. 15.9% in bed nights. Remember, I think the point to mention here, which is very interesting, is our tourism is being driven a lot by domestic tourism as a new market. So we've had an international source market that have sustained the business, especially the US, the UK, India, and China. But you find in the top five now, we have Uganda. And you will see the growth that Uganda has given us. So if you look at the markets, the US was up 17%. Now the type of tourist that the US market brings is what we call a high-end tourist. So for a market like this, you can imagine when you're having an election and having a conversation around as people killing people in the game reserves, fighting with herders, and these are our neighbors, we live with them after that. You know when you have a conversation about there being disagreement or conflict, human wildlife conflict with herders, we in this room understand that we're not going to get up and start running around. But when I'm sitting in America and I was going to a conservancy, what do you think I hear? What is the message you think I hear? So the report says, rancher killed, conflict between owners and herders. What do you think that person hears? They hear security. Do you think they think I'm going to go to that camp? We know that the, in the Mara, you can find one conservancy that is on 55,000 acres. So if there's a fight going on the corner of the 55,000 acres, there's actually other camps that are over there, where people are completely enjoying the safari, they're going on with their business, and are secure. It's something that we don't talk enough about. It's how secured our tourism circuit are. They are deliberately secured. So even as journalists, as you write, always put a caveat down there that says, however, all our circuits are secured. So it's really important, even as a tourism board, we, every time something happens, we have to issue a statement and share this statement with our stakeholders around the world and justify to them to a point where we put a map to show the conversation you're currently having when you talk about the Mara or Laikipia or Mandera or whatever, this is where it is. Because also you come from the premise that you believe everybody knows what the locations of things are. When I say Kisumu, you just assume that your visitor sitting in India knows where that is. And yes, I know Google is your friend and you can find a map, but they don't do that, right? So there's a time we have to actually show where it is that we're talking about and how far it is from where you want it to go. So that people understand that there's a difference between where they're going as relates to what it is that is being talked about. So US continues to be our number one market, UK is our number two market with 11% growth. Between the US and UK, they've always been our key source markets for the past 20 years. And the reason is, number one, we've invested a lot in those markets in terms of communication, in terms of advertising, in terms of marketing, in terms of actual green market agents that sell the destination specifically and exclusively. And then the experience that those agents, because they're fairly high-end agents, so they manage the experience that their clients have end-to-end. But I'll talk about that a bit in terms of from a transformation perspective. Next, like I said, our third market is Uganda. Anybody you trade with can be your visitor. So you have Rwanda, and you remember, because these countries tend to be landlocked. So if you trade with somebody, it means you can make them your visitor. You just have to find what of interest can you give them that they don't have. So if you think about Africa, you have a latent audience in Africa, even before you start selling to other countries, and I'll show you the split between continents. And you start to see the opportunities that there are. So the question somebody had earlier that said, what is our future in terms of how we'll grow the industry? You start from the point that says, you look at the product, and we talked about the product for a while here. We'll now come and look at the continents. Where will these people come from? Then we'll look at experiences and channels, right? So then we have India. And India is a sort of interesting country because India, we have both the aspect of people coming to visit their families, because we have a lot of people who either are second or third generation Indians that have become Kenyans. So you have that sort of latent, I'm going to visit my family. But also in terms of experiencing safari, beach, and the offerings that we have in Kenya, they have been one of the countries that we've seen growth year on year. They are a fairly easy country to market to, and in terms of their travel patterns, they travel in groups. So you can understand the growth that they're able to bring quite easily, right? Then, is this surprising? China, 11.8%. Are you surprised about that? Why not? And remember, they're far. If you don't train, you just get dizzy when you get there. Why is that not so easy?
Like you said, a lot of our trading partners.
Exactly. What's happened with the Chinese market is you now have four different generations. You have millennials, you have Generation Y, you have Generation X, and then you now have the Greys. And they all travel. Like, they all travel. And when they travel in groups. So they're not like the Americans and people from the UK who can travel as solo travelers or just as a family unit traveler or just a group. But they travel in groups. And they travel across countries and continents. And they want new experiences all the time. And because they're new travelers, they're really new travelers. There's people who, I think somebody was telling me, only 6% of people in Asia that have passports. 6%. And can you imagine how many there are? 6% have passports. So they're new travelers. So there's a really good opportunity for us to tap into that market, to grow their propensity to travel to the destination. Let's come to the continent. In terms of how the regions perform, what you must think in your mind is the population compared to the percentage. So Europe is not surprising, but look at Africa. And remember also the other challenges that Africa has. If Africa's contribution currently is 29%, but think about all our African challenges. Despite all our African challenges, we are still fairly close to a market like Europe that tend to have very affluent
relations, have a lot of have a lot of experience in travel, and travel a lot. Okay.
America's is 15%, but that's all off a fairly big base. Right?
Asia is growing. Middle East is small. First, is surprising.
There's two issues. There's issues around what they're used to and what they've been able to develop within their own continent, but more importantly, within their own region. But more importantly, they prefer a very high-end experience. Now, let me define high-end. Okay? The level of luxury that they want to have when they travel is hardly offered by most destinations, except a fairly highly developed destination, and most of them are in Europe, because they will travel with, they'll travel from home like they are from home. So they'll travel with their cars, they travel with their all of their family, they want to go there and be able to have the sorts of foods that they're used to, they want to be able to have enough halal restaurants. So those nuances are not a deterrent, they are an opportunity for you to create within a destination like Kenya, because you do have people either from the Middle East or that are Muslims that live in Kenya, that we can develop a product for them to be able to consider a destination, right? Then when we look at the purpose of travel, actually I should have asked you, what did you think people traveled for?
It's mainly money. For us, what this tells us is there's a huge opportunity, leave visiting friends and relatives, eh? There's a huge opportunity in business and conferencing, and we call it MICE, yeah? Meetings, Incentives, and Conferences, because what that does is when you have a party of 6,000 people or 3,000 people coming for a conference, what that means is you just earned yourself some 3,000 tourists who had no intention of coming to your country. When you have 3,002 people who are already there anyway, they're not spending their money, they have to be there because they're at a conference or they've come for work, it means that if you give them a good experience, the chances that they would come back with their family of one or two or three is very high. So if you look at the multiplier effect of that, then it immediately becomes an area that we need to be focusing on. Right? So the thing to note is tourism, the whole point, so that's the background of the stats around tourism that makes it an important sector. Now, let's move to the section where we talk about where it is today so that we can get to the point about where it needs to be in the future. So, the thing about tourism is in the past 5 years, the expectation and the structure and face of tourism has changed. So, it's shifted significantly. So a couple of years ago, what people expected when they came to a market was this, which is relaxation. Just think about the tourists that you met maybe 10 years ago. Yeah, you left your country to come and lie down in some places. It sounds really bad. But really, tourism was not as diversified, it was not as dynamic, it was not as experiential, it was not as exciting. People were not, there was not a generation of people that thrive on adventure. This is what tourism is today. Tourism is so busy. And people globally have so many options of what they can do. We mentioned you going up country and sitting in the woods and a tree and thinking, oh, I'm just a country. People make that a tourism experience. You mentioned people going to trek up or going to the river. Something as simple as going to the river, people create all experiences around it. And the way to create experiences around this is to understand that it's an experience and to understand the consumer. So like I said, the consumer has changed significantly. So the consumer today is not a traveler who just sees what they are seeing. The consumer today is a tourist that goes to a destination to see what they came to see.
So they go somewhere. Remember, every day they sit and they are on, and I'll show you a slide that shows by 2020, people will have, there'll be more devices than the population. 5 times more devices than the population, because people have multiple form factors that they see things on. So you're here, you walk down this corridor, you see something on the screen. You get to reception, there's a thing running around at the reception. You get into a cab, you see this coming up soon. When you get into an Uber, there'll be a screen there, sharing something with you. You get out of the cab, you're trying to go to a restaurant, there's a thing on the side of the road that is telling you a lot of information. You look at your phone, you're searching for something, things are popping up on the side, telling you all kinds of things. So, in terms of how much information people are getting, people get a lot of information. And that thing of saying, I'll travel to Africa as a bucket list finished a long time ago. In fact, people threw away bucket lists when it comes to travel, they use it for other things, but like, you can use bucket lists for other things. But for travel, people throw away the bucket list because there's so many experiences that you can have. So if we as a country want to transform tourism, we have to understand that offering a beach and safari experience is like having people eat bread and Blue Band every day, which they will not do. So really, that's where we are. We've got a great safari experience, an okay beach experience, but we have so many other experiences within the country today that have not been developed to be export ready, but they exist. Did you, for example, know that in Pokot, they have an elephant migration corridor with a tunnel that goes under and comes out on the other side? Did you know that? Did you see the white giraffes? Did you know they exist? Do you know they're also white crocodiles? They're white crocodiles. Just here. See, just here in Kilke. Do you know they exist? Zip lining, we've told you about so many, isn't it? Did you know there were caves? How did you know there were caves? Because we told you, right? Did you know that the Rift Valley is the only Rift Valley in the world? Yes. Our Rift Valley. Do you know that?
Yes.
How many times do you travel past that Rift Valley and how do you look at it? We have so many things that even we as Kenyans don't know exist. So you see, what we need to do is understand this is exactly what happens. How much do you think a traveler would pay to come for that experience? What is that? You think that's a sort of mass market experience? It's not. Because you think about the distance, you think about the location, you think about what the person will see, which, by the way, they cannot see in any other part of the world, because they won't find another report that's going to do that, right? So what's the gap? We found the product, so what's the gap? What do you think the gap is?
The infrastructure,
the ecosystem. Yes, that's what it is. So Kenya, as a destination, is amongst one of the most marketable, competitive destinations that we have, not only in Africa, but in the world. But it lacks the infrastructure to make the products export ready. That's it. So you know there are some countries that don't have product. Like Dubai had desert. Jordan has got people fighting on desert. Okay? There's some people that have 3 attractions. I mean, if you think about how many attractions do you think Rwanda has? Imagine genocide museum. I'm talking about attractions, genocide museum. But it's true, it's right. What else do they have?
Gorillas.
Gorillas? They're clean. Have you seen? Did you see how quickly you finished with that story? Yeah. So the point that we need to understand is we will not have a problem with what to sell. That's not what the problem is. Is it ready for sale? And that really is the transformation for tourism. Somebody asked there, what are your future plans of how to the tourism industry? Our future plans is, we now had a national stakeholder forum that is not about, you know, those nice things that corporate bodies sit in a memorization and you have tea for 3 days or whatever. No, we included counties. Because one of the things that is obvious in Kenya is the product is not sitting with the private sector stakeholder. The product is sitting in the county. So what devolution has done is it has opened our eyes to meet somebody from Nyandarua, Pokot, Mandera, Wajir, to tell me about that thing that the gentleman just told us about. Otherwise, you wouldn't know. So in terms of a strategy, we are now developing what we are calling top experiences and signature experiences. But let me just explain the difference. The signature experience is exactly what you talked about, which is authentic and unique to that area. So what you do is you now come with all our bodies, which is TFC, we now go and do our visit. And we do, this is not a conversation that we're having, which is a presentation. This is now the reality. We have county engagements, because there's a couple of challenges within the county. There's capacity building challenges, there's infrastructure challenges, there's financing challenges, there's investment challenges. But you need to understand that usually money is not the problem, because money follows ideas. So the ideas already exist. Because if you can, just the conversation that you had is not very difficult to find. So that is the future of tourism. It's about top experiences and signature experiences and developing the diversity of the Kenyan tourism product. That is really all we're going to do. Once we do that, even if we didn't market it, we just posted a picture of it on Instagram. Because this is what is going on, we won't have a lot of problems. Look at this. This is currently the world population of connected devices. So if I post something on Instagram, I have a latent audience of about 50 billion people that can see it. So you see how my work as a marketing agency suddenly becomes really easy, right? If you look at the connected devices per person by 2020, there'll be more connected devices than people. And 2020 is not far away. It's just now. Which means if you have something to show, everybody will see it. So in terms of a strategy, so that now we are now beginning to unpack the product. So you see, we've talked about the potential, we're now talking about the product, and we know we have the product. So now we just have to present it in an export-ready fashion and help people to have a view of where this can be and what it can look like. So we have opportunities like this. 51% found it very appealing to view through virtual reality a destination that they go to. So in terms of having somebody sitting there doing a sales speech like a salesman on the road tarmacking, those stories ended. That way of selling finished a long time ago. Because the whole world has changed so significantly, even if you look at the way people operate here, you can have a whole conversation without ever sitting in front of a computer, just by having one phone. You can run your whole day with your phone. Which means you can market an entire destination through a device. So it stops being about investment. And it starts being about, do you have something to market? And is it ready? And that really is what we're thinking about. So we move, this is going to be the future of tourism. And the future of marketing for tourism. Because you ask us, what is the tourism work going to do? We're not going to get tons of money where we're going to be in mainstream media, talking to however million, billions of people there are in the world. All we have to do is put it somewhere where they're looking. What you can't see here in my style, is this here. The sources of search for travel now
is at 74% on digital. This is from two operators and two agents as compared to 23 or 34%. So even people who want to, just think about it, when you're traveling, if you want to travel to Mombasa or Kericho or Malindi or Naivasha, how do you do it? Do you go to a travel agent?
No.
How do you do it? That was rather strong. Okay. You who doesn't go to a travel agent, how do you do it?
You get my way there.
You get your way there?
Yeah.
How do you do it? Go online, there's Google,
TripAdvisor.
There's TripAdvisor.
TripAdvisor.
No, even to Naivasha. Anywhere.
No,
you drive. Or you just take public means. And then, oh, you need a hotel, you need to sleep. How do you achieve that?
Just walk around.
Here, you walk around. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you walk around. Yeah. How else?
You arrive dinner.
Yeah, you can arrive dinner. You talk to drivers. So, you see, if that's the way, if all we have to do, because you'll get there anyway. So, unless we are in your face with things that help you, so you want to come to a point, or the point that we are coming to is where the technology is such that if we are seated here on your phone, you should be able to have to understand how many banks are around you. What restaurants are around you? Where can you stay? What is the rate at the night of one? Just sitting here on your phone. That really is what marketing is about. It's about making sure you have the best content, the best channel, and the best customer. Because what is currently happening is people themselves aggregate content or user-generated content. So even as a tourism body, we started off with campaigns, but we will not create campaigns anymore. All we have told our stakeholders and general Kenyans, if you shoot something and it's of interest, just send it to us, we'll upload it for you if you give us the rights for it. So anybody in this room, if you have an experience, like when you go back to Pokot or somewhere close by there, and you see this, capture them on your phone and send them to us. We'll upload them for you on Magical Kenya. And that really is how destinations market themselves, because if I see that this is an upload from Joseph Kikwete, I don't sit in India thinking, this must be this tourism board trying to cheat me about this place. Or if Dorothy sees it, she doesn't think, this person can't know what he's talking about. She immediately says, this guy actually is from there, so this must be true, so this must be the way it is. So from a marketing perspective, marketing has changed. People do not want you to tell them through an ad how that experience will be. They want somebody who has the experience to show them how the experience is. So if you look at now, the customer purchase journey, again, a MICE type arrangement. If you start here, you have to make them aware. We just come in this space here as a marketing body, because after that, every other platform takes over. Google takes over, TripAdvisor, your phone, the person you met on the road, everything else that you see, the cab that you got into. So many, the airline, what you see in the airline, what you saw in the shops, what you meet on your Instagram, your Pinterest. So many other things take over the marketing of that destination. So the work of the destination is making sure that they have breathtaking experiences that they can post so somebody can see. That's it. After that, it happens by itself, because if you come to now, getting to a point where you're saying, somebody asked a question, so we'd like to know what the tourism board is going to do to change tourism or move tourism forward. We will just package what it is and make sure that it is exported. That's all we have to do. Identify all of the gems that we have in terms of influencers, in terms of celebrities, in terms of unique locations, in terms of authentic experiences, in terms of adventure experiences, anything that somebody else has seen. So we're not saying that we know them all. If any of you ever go anywhere and you see something, just capture it on your phone and tag us. We'll upload it. And that really is
we move from tourists to traveler and attractions, and from attractions to experiences. This thing of here is the tourist attraction and this is the bedroom and this is what the bed looks like and this is what the food will look like and this is the chef standing there smiling at you and these are the dancers that will meet you at the door. That story finished. You know those pictures that have a plate of food or a bedroom? People don't go to places to they need to sleep in a good bed, but that's not what took them. They can as well sleep in the bed they had at home. So what else will they see? No, they will not go to the restaurant and see your incredible food platter. That's, it's great, but that's not what took them there. So what else will they see? And that is really what changes the traveler from the tourist. The traveler sees whatever there is you have to show them. The tourist comes to see what they came to see there. So you see, if you consider it like that, just take the top part. 15 markets, top 15 markets account for 82% of travel queries about Kenya. You can see how many there. There's US, UK, Germany, Italy, India, Poland, France, Spain, South Africa. So if we were ready, we would really be ready. Because the question they ask, the number one Kenya request, related question they ask is, what language will I reach there? What is there to do? So they know we have runners. So now they might know we have Lupita, they know Obama, took no advantage of. Okay, so they know we had a president of the most powerful country in the world for 2 terms. What else do you think they know? Sorry? They know? They know we have two presidents to do a great job of making sure they know that. What else do they know? I mean, this is true. So what else do they know? They know we have the big five, but so does Botswana, so does Tanzania, so does Zimbabwe. Really. What else do they know? Yeah, they know the which vibrate from Tanzania, in case you didn't know. Yes. What else do they know?
We have the first Chief Justice to turn a presidential
election in Africa. Exactly. Now you see, they will not come to experience it. The guy turned it down and has finished. That is news and is gone. Unless they come to look for him, to ask him why he turned it down. But that's not a great experience. It would be nice to meet him. But after they meet him, what else will they do?
They want to see where he was born.
Exactly. Now you're getting there.
The woman who bore him.
Okay. So now that becomes an experience. When they go to see where he was born, then they see other things. They see their goats, they have different sorts of houses, they wear different types of clothes. And that's the sort of experience that you want to. So when you're writing that story as a journalist, don't stop at the fact that the guy was the first Chief Justice. Talk about, take that story a bit further. You're a journalist, you have imagination. Use it. Because remember, people believe you. They believe you more than they believe me. So you need to use that power. So when you talk about the country that has two presidents, show them other things that country has. Like you can't concentrate on that story from page 1 until page 24. Show some other things that you can do there. We are all, did you know that we are the only country with a national park in the city center? Surely you can say, here is where he was sworn in, but about 20 kilometers on this direction, you have a national park, you guys. Like also, the guys are going to read that story anyway, so you might as well give them something else to read. About 30 kilometers that side, you can have breakfast with giraffes. Did you know that? That are so kind, they kiss you for coming. You see, so it's that sort of narrative that you want to make sure that, yes, you have to write what you have to write because people have to read what they have to read. But you have to try and market the destination and showcase the destination. So things like TripAdvisor, this is stuff that you know, right? Look at that. $1.1 million. Did you see that Nairobi was voted the number one city for things to visit 2 weeks ago. Is it 2 weeks ago? Was it number one or number three? Nairobi was number three. Do you guys see? Just because we showcased it with things to do on TripAdvisor. Just that. We didn't change our governor, which you all talk about. We didn't change the things that we did in the city. Yeah. We just showed what you can do in Nairobi. So it's really important to build content. Because content, we're creating content communities, and you guys is one community. The other person that's walking on the street is another community. The people that are marketing the country or just experiencing the country are another community. Anybody who has content that we can aggregate is a community. So what we're trying to do is make sure that we connect real experiences with people. So what you see is not an ad that has got Maasai's jumping, then has a balloon thing, then it has a coastline, then it has us meeting you at the airport. It's simple things like this. You can imagine if me, I'm sitting in, where is a horrible place to be sitting? In Russia. I'm sitting in Russia. You know how cold it is, like minus 20 now. And the caption comes up and says, Jimmy is having breakfast with a new friend in Kenya. Do you know how that person in 30 degrees is feeling? Minus 30 degrees. So, your messaging starts to change completely. You start to show different things. So, what you're doing is you are then allowing people to come to a place where they can either decide that they want to accept, to be able to see more about that place, which then moves them onto a portal that allows them to see the location, allows them to see hotels, allows them to see how they can book, and it starts to change the way that they come to the place, right? So you have something that just started with a Pinterest that says somebody's having breakfast somewhere, now becomes a selling tool. Something as simple as just aggregating this information, you customize and put active links. Because remember, I showed you by 2020, everybody has a thing. It now pops up on your computer, it pops up on your phone, you're here, you can see, it can be a pop-up that comes and you decide whether you're going to accept it. But what it does, it starts to make even you the Kenyan city in Kenya. If Dorothy posted the Rift Valley and has a great shot of it, the first thing you'll ask, and Kenyans do it so that, where is this? They always ask, where is this? And it's Kenya. So what we then need to do is you then move from saying it's the best country, come see the runners, you put a nice ad, you just show what the people who are there are having and doing as you sit in your very cold country or your very hot country. Okay? That way, you start to move the marketing strategy to a live experience. So people don't feel like you're selling them something. You're just sharing what they can't have. Yeah, so then they have to decide if they want to have it or not. You just share what they can't have. So if I'm in the Rift Valley, I'm just in the Rift Valley. I'm sorry that you're not in the Rift Valley. However, if you'd like to come to the Rift Valley, you could come to the Rift Valley. If I'm sitting under a tree and experiencing people making beads, which I'm now wearing, I'm really sorry you're not sitting in the village where they make beads, and I'm sorry that you don't have beads to wear, but I do. But you can also have beads to wear. So it changes the conversation completely. So what becomes your life strategy is you look at trends, new trends and innovation. You use social media, real time. So it's not about, it's not contrived, and it's not also difficult. You know, the same way you have breaking news, you have trending, you have Kenyans on Twitter shouting, you just have experiences just like that on a day-to-day basis. So what in essence you have is just a live broadcast strategy. So every day people discover something new. So this thing of put up a mobile app, and let's use that app if you want to go to Kenya, and then you can see what it is we do. You move away from that. And we're moving to real time, which is the messenger bots, which is what I was showing you. It messages real-time things which people are doing and they are posting. So from the perspective of how then you market the entire country, it means that if at 5 you're having a sundowner on Lake Victoria, somebody else in Nairobi is at a bar, another one in Mount Kenya is on top of a mountain, somebody's probably at a wedding ceremony in the court, somebody at the corner over there could be feeding elephants at Sydney Sheldrick, at Daphne Sheldrick, and somebody could be in the Mara watching the migration. So you can imagine if you're sitting somewhere and you're connected and you see eight things, eight different, completely different things, and they show you the location of where they are. Can you see how suddenly the destination is not about whether they were choosing a new president or they were throwing stones or burning tires or doing whatever. It becomes a completely different view of what's going on in that location. So moving ahead, basically all we're saying is we have to ensure that we have an adaptive strategy. And you see, adaptive strategy is a lot of English. It is exactly what I just said, right? You make sure that you're using technology to showcase the destination. You make sure that you're not window dressing the experience. Because if you window dress something, you guys are journalists, you will know that it's window dressed. You make sure that you make informed choices in terms of what you're going to adopt into new technology. So just get what people are using and share it. So people stop feeling such pressure of figuring out, is this real or is this not real? And that really is what is moving into us. Before I close, somebody mentioned something about making tourism amongst the big four. So what we need to do, and this is something that is a live action, is to showcase the potential that tourism has, as well as the investments that are required in order to get that potential, and map out the sustainability of that potential, and present that as a cabinet paper, in order to ensure that somebody sits down and realizes there's a sector that actually needs to be amongst the top, or it can be the top five. And that's it. Thank you very much for being such an interesting audience.